In Revelation 3:2, the church of Sardis was warned to wake up and strengthen what remains,
yeah,
which is about to die. Well, that's exactly what our guest has been saying to the American church. Please welcome New York Times bestselling author and number one radio host, Eric Metaxas. Come on in.
I'm doing all right.
You didn't know you were number one.
I hope this isn't live, is it?
No, that's prophecy. That was prophecy. Don't worry about it.
Scared me. Scared me for a second.
How are you doing?
I'm doing very well. I was just weeping because the anointing of God on the worship. I didn't expect to come in here and worship this morning. You can't fake the anointing.
Oh, amen.
Can't.
No, so amen. What a joy.
Thank
what a
you.
Joy to be in the presence of the Lord. You know, thank you.
Amen. You know, I'll say, Eric, we say this all the time, that we never take for granted the presence of the Lord that's in the studio, because we can't touch people, but the Holy Spirit, His presence can actually go through those cameras,
yeah,
and touch people.
Yeah.
And I know that you've done radio shows before where there was an anointing to share a certain topic and people would be touched, but
yeah,
it wasn't about you.
No, amen. Well, better not be.
We'll right? be in trouble amen. If it is,
yeah,
for sure.
Yeah.
Well, so many exciting things happening. I want to say thank you for having me. You were my first interview.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah. The book, Through the Storm.
That was thank wonderful. You. That was wonderful to
yeah.
hear your story, man.
Yeah,
wow.
There were several people that reached out to me, and one especially lady who just lost her husband. He, you know, graduated to heaven, and she said it was such an encouragement to hear, you know, God's going to
yeah.
bring you through.
Yeah.
Okay, so many things to talk about. Where are we going to go first? What are you thinking? How are you feeling?
Don't ask me, because who knows where I'll take it.
You want to talk about the documentary?
Well, yeah. I mean, look, let me start. There's good news and there's bad news. The bad news is America is in free fall. America is a dumpster fire. Evil people have taken control of this nation. And if you don't know that, you should. Things are so evil and sick that many people who would not ordinarily go there realize the only answer could be God. The only answer could be the Lord. There's no doubt about it. And I think that's Romans 8:28. All these horrible things. I mean, a bridge collapsing, you didn't mention it. The name of the bridge, the Francis Scott Key Bridge. He wrote the Star Spangled Banner. These are like prophetic signs of God's judgment to wake up the church of Jesus Christ. Many of us have been sleeping. The Lord says, I need you to be awake. I need you to be, on all cylinders for yeah. my purposes, not for America's purpose, but for my purposes.
Amen.
So that ultimately is what the Lord put on my heart, and it's why I wrote Letter to the American Church, which I think I've said it here before. I never felt the Lord direct me to write something in this way. Like, it's just, you know, you can't make that up, and I wouldn't ever say that if it weren't very real. And it was so real. So when the book came out, it struck a nerve, and it's been going all over the country. And these two people, two Hollywood veterans, said, we need to make this into a documentary film. They made it. It is spectacular. I can't take credit for it because I didn't make the film. I'm in the film.
Yeah.
But it's the message of Letter to the American Church. And we're offering it free to any church that wants to do a screening for free. It's not free for people to see it, but just
yeah.
for churches. Because I believe it's the Lord's message to the church.
You know, I think we have a clip because, you know, there's no greater time, of course, for the American church to rise up, confront evil, and be the voice of truth. It was called to be. So let's take a look at Eric Metaxas' documentary, Letter to the American Church, that is already shaking the faith of believers across our nation. Let's watch.
I'm convinced that the American church has arrived at a significant moment of truth.
We are only 75, 80 years removed from three separate regimes that killed 60 to 70 million people intentionally.
The parallels with where the American church is now to where the German church stood in the face of the Nazi regime are unavoidable and grim.
Churches need to understand really what Marxism is, which is to destroy the church, to destroy the word of God.
So if you capture the seminaries, you capture the pastors, you capture the laity, you capture the soul of the world.
Christianity is not just about saying Jesus loves you and then going to heaven one day, but that there's a war that's raging.
The church is weakening, which is why Marxism is ascendant in America today.
This is the hour of the American church.
Now, you really could see a shift, like in 2020.
Yes.
With COVID.
Yes.
And you were here.
Yes.
And even at that point, we really couldn't see what was behind all of that.
But I remember listening to you talk about the vaccine and stuff, and I was thinking, I was not there yet. I was still figuring it out.
Right.
But I got there pretty quick. My wife was there. And you start thinking, this can't be happening. This can't happen in America. Mm. And I have a lot of grace for people who can't bear the thought that these things are really happening. And you could go down the line.
Well, you know, Dr. Simone Gold was here yesterday.
No, I didn't know that.
She was here. She said,
she's a friend.
She said to tell you
man.
Hello.
Yes.
And so, but think about what happened to her. So she was telling us on January 6th how that, you know, both sides of the Capitol, one was peaceful. There was some stuff going on the other, but we only saw the other. We never saw the peaceful.
And we don't even know who was doing the other. That was not, you know, our people.
Exactly.
That was government plants. I mean, again, in America, to think that the government
so
would be involved in that.
And so here she goes into, the doors are open.
Yep.
The crowd just goes in. She says a few words and then goes out 12 days later.
Yeah.
The FBI knocks down her door
with
guns pointed on her, handcuffed her, and took her in. And of course, you know, how many people there on January 6th are still...
You're still in jail.
In
Simone
jail
and I have a mutual dear friend, John Strand.
She talked about
loves him. Jesus.
He's still in there.
He is in prison, okay? Now, you see, if you're not mad at this injustice, I think, are you dead inside? Do you not care? This is why people say, well, we just want to do church. I don't want to be political. God, and this is the message of Letter to the American Church, God calls us to not say, well, I'm just going to do church. No, that's the devil's church. You need to be the church everywhere. And every sphere where you see injustice, where you see lies, you see corruption, you see confusion, deception, it is our job to speak about that, not to say, well, that's not my thing. The Lord has called it our thing.
And she had been invited there for... to talk about medical freedom.
Yeah.
And there were several senators that were involved, and last minute they canceled, so she was still there.
Yeah.
So she had been invited.
Yeah.
And you think about the fact that she was, you know, arrested and then went to trial. They charged her with a 20-year felony. This is a medical doctor and a lawyer who has never done anything but help people.
This is in America. I just want people to understand, ladies and gentlemen, if you're stunned to the point where you can't believe it, believe me, I get that. It's impossible to process, but we need to process it. I think American Christians are naive about evil. We've been so blessed in America that we forget there is satanic evil, but we kind of, we've moved past that. Maybe they have that in other countries, or maybe they have that in the past. No, it is here. And we are, for the first time in our lifetimes, seeing it revealed. It's been mostly hidden. We've been, you know, things are fine.
Right.
Well, things are not fine, but we need to wake up, acknowledge it, and get in the fight. If you're not in the fight against evil, in I think both these books, imagine if the slave trade was happening or slavery was happening. You say, well, that's not my issue. The Lord died for those people that have been enslaved. And you're going to say, well, I just want to do church. Yeah. That's the devil's church. That's not God's church. God calls you to take the suffering of those people, and we're commanded to love our neighbors. How are we going to do that?
Founding,
are we going to just do that by singing songs?
The founding fathers didn't imagine a secular culture.
Yes.
Because none of them were, few of them were secular.
That's right.
So they had
even
this
even the secular ones weren't secular.
Yeah, the secular ones
even
now
Franklin
they'd be running on the Republican ticket, right?
Yeah.
But I mean, you have this, the culture that was birthed in Christian values to the point where almost all the leaders were Bible taught, Bible believing.
Yeah.
Even if they weren't living it, they knew it.
Yes.
Right? And they were teaching it in the schools.
Yeah.
And that's how you learned your alphabet. And they were living in a culture where there was congruence between Christianity and government.
Yes.
And now we're living in a culture when we remove God out of education, now we have a secular versus a Christian culture.
Correct.
And that's where we are today. And it's not just our government. This is an international play.
But when you say secular, this is what's so interesting. Secular sounds kind of neutral, right? Secular
is really demonic. It's
atheistic, right. Yeah. Which is demonic.
Right.
And we are, for the first time in our lifetimes, seeing it. Mm-hmm. In other words, we're seeing things, you know, what do we need to mention? Transgender lunacy, chopping body parts off children.
Devil worship in schools.
Open borders with military-age men flooding in. I mean, everywhere you look, it's madness. And at the heart of it is atheistic Marxism. It's atheistic. Mm-hmm. And so it's not just, oh, we don't believe in God. They are at war with God.
Amen.
And we're not used to that in America, but the Lord has called us to this hour.
You know, I want you to talk about Bonhoeffer, the book you wrote, because I know at the time you wrote it, you could have never imagined that the American church would come this close to the German church.
No.
During that time period. But I want to show a testimonial from your documentary, because this is one of the big things we're facing, folks, and we've got to speak out on it. And in fact, Dr. Gold yesterday told me about a story that I'm going to bring to Daystar about the hidden agenda that's going on in some of the hospitals with transgender surgeries on children.
Yep.
I mean, something that happened right here in our area, and that but a brave doctor uncovered, where they said they weren't doing the surgeries, but they actually were doing it, and they were hiding it, and they weren't documenting insanity. But here's the story, because the message behind Eric's documentary, Letter to the American Church, it couldn't be more timely for today's generation, government, and medical teams, of course, who are set on confusing children and, yes, mutilating bodies. Here's a testimony from a young girl named Chloe Cole and the horror that she experienced after being diagnosed with gender dysphoria. There are scads of these stories now. Here's just one. Watch this.
My name is Chloe Cole, and I am a detransitioner. At the age of 12, I began to experience what my medical team would later diagnose as gender dysphoria. The gender specialist I was taken to see told my parents that I needed to be put on puberty-blocking drugs right away. They asked my parents a simple question. Would you rather have a dead daughter or a living transgender son? I was fast-tracked onto puberty blockers and then testosterone. The resulting menopausal-like hot flashes made focusing on school impossible. I still get joint pains and weird pops in my back, but they were far worse when I was on the blockers. I had a double mastectomy at 15. After my breasts were taken away from me, the tissue was incinerated. The drugs and surgeries changed my body, but they did not and could not change the basic reality that I am and forever will be a female. However, at 16, after my surgery, I did become suicidal. I'm doing better now, but my parents almost got the dead daughter promised to them by my doctors. My childhood was ruined, along with thousands of detransitioners that I know through our networks. This needs to stop. You alone can stop it. Enough children have already been victimized by this barbaric pseudoscience. Please let me be your final warning. Thank you.
How many stories are out there now like this? This is insanity. Who could have imagined even 5 years ago that we would be hearing these crazy stories? I mean, how far is the American church going to allow this to go?
Well, see, that's the point. Tony, I got to tell you, I've been so sickened to think that many people listening to this program are going to churches that are looking the other way. They say, we just want to do church.
Right.
Well, when I wrote the Bonhoeffer book, I understood that's exactly what allowed satanic evil to take over Germany and much of Europe. What was it? It was churches saying, we just want to do church. We just want to look the other way. And the reason I wrote the book and we've come out with a documentary is to wake up those in the American church who can be awakened. And that's why we're making it free to churches. It's like, please consider this. Mm-hmm. Because if we look the other way, as so many people are going to church and they're tithing to churches that are looking the other way now. So we see these horrible things and we think, we're supposed to be in this fight. Your church is supposed to be in this fight. And there's so many fights, but it's all the Lord calling his people to stand against evil, whether it means being political or not. The Lord doesn't have categories. We're supposed to do whatever he calls us to do. And people are trying to shut down the voice of the church. They call it Christian nationalism. We need to fight against it. And again, it's why we made a film of Letter to the American Church, because we want to get this out to anybody who has eyes and ears to see.
How do they hear. Do that? How do they get to that? Share the
just
website.
The website, lettertothemericanchurch.com. Everything is there. You can get the book, you can get the DVD, and you can sign up for a free screening, no strings attached, at your church. And there's a list of churches that are already doing free screenings, but we're desperate to get the message out. But I ask everybody, please go to the website, share it with your friends. everything is at stake. As America goes, so goes the whole world. Mm. And as the American church goes, so goes America.
Yes, sir.
You know, we're going to have John, Pastor John, I can't say
his last name. Amanchukwu.
Yes, Amanchukwu.
He's a friend, yes.
Right. And what an amazing witness he has been, had the boldness to go before the school board in North Carolina. I don't know if you can get that little clip together, Delisha, to show everyone, but what a difference he's made mm-hmm. after standing up to the school
yes.
board and with the parents
yes.
in the room and how they treated him.
And you know he's in the film.
Yeah.
Yeah, we have six guests, and he's one of the lead ones in Letter to the American Church, because there we need to see the battle, and we need to see people who are fighting the battle to be inspired to join them.
Mm-hmm. So he gets up, and this is for elementary
yep.
school,
yep.
library, and he starts reading these books with this
pornography
and filth. And
yes.
it's okay, you know, and I mean...
And you know the story, right? He's reading this stuff and saying, this is in your children's libraries. Your children can read this filth, but you won't let me read it at the school board meeting.
No, they spoke up and said, stop, this is inappropriate.
Yeah.
So let's watch this little clip. I mean, this is what we're going to have to do, folks.
This book here, it's called It's Perfectly Normal. I'll read some of this for you. It says, after a bit, a person's it becomes moist and slippery, and the becomes hard. After a bit, a person's becomes erect, stiff, and larger.
Pastor,
sometimes a bit of clear fluid that may contain
two
sperm comes out of the tip of the and makes it wet.
Can we, sir, I'm sorry.
Was it something I said? If you don't want to hear it in a school board meeting, why should children be able to check it out of the school system? We have perverts that are perverting our kids. And you all sit back smug in your chairs, but you don't want me to read it. Why? Does it bother you? Yes or no? You can't answer that question. You want to know why? Because politically speaking, you can't say that it's wrong. And you don't want me to read the filth because it exposes the truth. How dare you tell me to stop reading it? If you don't want to hear it, why should the children have to see it?
Pastor, your time is up. Thank you.
That makes two of us.
All right. So it got pretty rowdy in there. I mean, I think they actually walked him out at some point. But as a result of him doing that and it going viral and people saying, wow, I didn't know this was going on
yep.
in my kid's school.
Yep.
This is a public school. These are elementary school kids. They, are you kidding me? Like you said, it's mm-hmm. pornography.
It's pornography.
This is something you deal with in helping mm-hmm. people get free from.
Yep.
Can you believe that we're opening our kids up to
that? Well, if you can sexually, I mean, if you go back to the Old Testament, the way, remember the story of Balaam, he couldn't get God to curse him. But so he went to the king and said, send your women down there, corrupt them morally. Okay, and what's happening is the enemy knows if he can corrupt a nation
yes.
morally, he's done it with Rome.
Yes.
He's done it with other cultures. Anytime there's a superpower, superpowers only lose their superpower status by immorality.
Yes.
Not by war.
And that is what is happening.
And that's exactly
now.
The plan.
Yes.
And so the
yes.
church has become immoral. I mean, 50% of the men yeah. are struggling with pornography.
Yeah.
But we're silenced because of that.
Yeah.
But we're seeing a culture say, we're going to go after the kids just like Molech worship.
Yeah.
And we're going to sacrifice our kids in surgeries and and we're going to do this. And then the judgment of God will come on a nation.
Oh, it's you know, happening.
It is happening now.
But imagine this happening in America, which on every level has been a Christian nation. Maybe not officially, but we have been profoundly Christian. And we're the only country that it was because of Christian faith that we believed we could govern ourselves. And we come into being. So the idea that this nation,
mm-hmm.
250 years after we were founded, would be having this level of immorality. So again, I say to the mm-hmm. church, hey, church, the Lord is pointing to you. If you are silent in the face of evil, you're much more guilty than mm-hmm. your unchurched neighbors, than mm-hmm. your pagan neighbors. The Lord is calling his people to stand and to fight. Again, it's why we made the film Letter to the American Church, because the church has to stand, and we have very little mm-hmm. time to do so. The time mm-hmm. Could not be shorter. I think we have this year, to be honest,
mm-hmm.
and if we don't do it this year, if we don't stand and link arms and fight this year, just like in Germany, the window shuts and it's over.
Well, and the church can go into like where it has in Europe, where it's become really irrelevant.
Yes.
It's symbolic.
That's a fact.
And I agree with you in the timing. We are in a time period where we need to stand up and do things. You know, and some of you, you're in this place in your own life. It's not a national issue for you. It's a personal issue. You're having crises and decisions, and things are coming into your life, and you're in significant pain. And it's time for you to say, Jesus, I need you. America needs you, yes, but you need him. And if that's you today, and your heart's crying out and saying, I need you, I just want you to say this simple prayer after me. Say, Jesus, forgive me of my sins. Come into my life. I want you, I want your Holy Spirit to guide me and be my Lord. In Jesus' name. And if you've said that prayer right now, there's a number on your screen. You see it, 1-800-329-0029. Call it or put it in your phone. Call us later. But let us know, because we want to send you a couple things. The book of John, okay? This is no ordinary book of John. In it is a QR code where Dr. Jean Getz explains what you've read so you understand the Word of God. And also a book called Now What? So you can walk out your Christian faith. But we want to hear from you. We want to pray with you. We want to just rejoice with you. 1-800-329-0029. And if you have any other needs, financial, relationship, personal, call, because it is a time to get ministry, to do it. That's why we do ministry now. We don't need to be afraid of the things that we're talking about, because this is our land.
Yeah.
This is our city. These are our schools. These are our children. And we have the authority, and I love what Eric is talking about today. Talk us a little bit through the religious Christianity, God's answer to evil.
Religionless Christianity.
It's an ugly title, and I want to say that up front. I know that, and I want to explain it, because it's meant... The reason I wrote... one of your producers who read this book said, this is like a trilogy. You got your Bonhoeffer book, A Letter to the American Church, and now Religionless Christianity. I never thought of it that way.
Wow.
But it's true, because the Bonhoeffer book, of course, is all about Bonhoeffer, this great hero. Mm-hmm. And what is this story of Bonhoeffer in a nutshell? In a nutshell, it's simple. He was rallying the church in Germany to stand against the satanic evil of the Nazis.
And he could see it.
And the church said, nah, we think it'll be fine. We just want to do church. We don't want to get political. And he was, you know, a prophetic voice saying, church, the Lord is calling you to stand, not to do church, to be the church.
Amen.
Not to go to church, to be the church.
You know, and everybody said, oh, it's okay, we'll shut the church down.
Oh,
the
listen.
Government they, said, we
yeah,
have
they
to
said,
do
oh,
it.
Romans 13, it's very clear. Whatever the government says, do it, you know. Worship Caesar, I guess the government tells us, you know, obviously scripture doesn't tell us to do what the government, whatever the government says, a little more complicated than Romans 13, but they didn't want any trouble. And that spirit of fear,
that's the spirit of fear,
is everywhere. And
yes.
The Lord says, okay, I will know that you are my believers, that you are my those who love me, if you know that my word says you're not supposed to have fear, you're supposed to live out your faith, right? So Bonhoeffer tried and tried, and obviously the church did not heed God's voice at that time. And
they
so satanic
not.
Evil came in, and when some of them woke up, it was like, oops. Now it's too late. Now the government has already made it impossible. We had a time when we could speak. We had a time when we could protest. That's gone. So at the end of his life, he's in prison. He writes a letter to his best friend. And this is all in the new book, Religionless Christianity. He writes a letter to his best friend. And he says, he's thinking about what has happened. And he says, what we needed in Germany was a religionless Christianity. In other words, we were just doing religion. We were just doing church. We didn't need dead religion. We needed bold faith in the Lord.
Yeah.
So true Christian faith is bold. It leaves the church on Sunday and goes everywhere 7 days a week. And it's not just this religion. So he used that awkward phrase. Forgive me. He used this awkward phrase. And I said, I want that to be the title of my book, because that's the answer to evil, to have true faith, not dead religion. And what has been the problem of the church? What was the problem of the believers that Jesus railed against? They knew the scripture backwards and forwards. They were unbelievably religious, and they hated God. And when God came to them, they rejected him and crucified him. And that's always the spirit of religion that is among the people of God, and it's always what the Lord is calling us away from. And that,
Amen.
To me, is exactly where we are in America now.
And I think that one of the things is the paradigms we use. When you use the paradigm of church, it kind of says us for and no more. When you use the paradigm of kingdom, it's a paradigm of let's take over.
Yes.
This is our land. This is our family.
Yes.
This is our time. And to celebrate that we've been given authority on earth as it is in heaven, and we are to rule and to reign.
Yeah.
And when we have preachers, and there are preachers who preach that message,
yeah,
those are the preachers that tend to get their people on school boards. They tend, yeah, to be the preachers who get the mayors elected.
Yeah.
They tend to be the preachers who are given spiritual authority because they decided that the kingdom of God is supposed to come in Toronto, Milwaukee, Cincinnati. It's ours to bring the kingdom of God. And I think shifting the church out of having a service to be of service is one of the paradigms we're moving towards. And that be of service isn't always teaching Sunday school. It's teaching real school. It's going and being
it's
a senator.
It's going everywhere.
It's going and being a city commissioner.
Yeah,
it's going and being,
amen,
a sheriff.
Amen.
You know, and be that voice of the kingdom of God on earth as it is in heaven. And I think as we make that shift, we'll move into religious Christianity.
Amen.
You know, as I was sitting here, just came to me that there are people watching that God is speaking to your heart about exactly what we're talking about. And you've actually been like more over here, and God has kind of moved you center, and like he's been dealing with you, and but you just didn't know if God could really fit into the equation of your life. And yet, maybe just in a nutshell, share about where you went to school and how you came to know the Lord.
Yeah.
Because you're a very smart, intelligent man. A lot of people like to listen to you because of that. But the God factor in you is still such an important part of everything.
It better be at the heart, otherwise, yeah, it's all, yeah, from the pit of hell. Let's be real clear, since time is short.
Yeah.
If it's not about the Lord utterly, it's from the devil. There's no neutral ground, right?
Right.
So yeah, look, I grew up in a working class home. My parents are working class European immigrants. I wrote a book called Fish Out of Water. I tell my story of growing up. And you know, we were in the Greek Orthodox Church every Sunday, but like a lot of people going to church, I never got the clarity on the scripture or whatever. It just kind of, religion, good people, but just mostly religion. So I go to Yale University. What is Yale University? Yale University is one of these places people go, oh, Yale. Well, guess what? Those places have all been taken over by Marxist atheist thinking.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I could speak for days about that. So I drank that Kool-Aid and kind of drifted off into, I don't know the meaning of life. In fact, I'm pretty sure life has no meaning, because if you pull God out, life has no meaning. What is good? What is evil? What do I do? It was a nightmare. And the Lord sovereignly came into my life and in a dream spoke to me. I was born again overnight. I was translated from darkness to light, literally overnight, changed everything. And I'm like, okay, Lord, I know you're real. I didn't even know you if you existed. Please guide me. So he has guided me. And I'll tell you something, it's amazing.
Amen.
When I wrote the Bonhoeffer book, I never dreamt that the Lord is opening a door for me to write all this stuff that this follows, this is gonna be happening in America, whatever. Mm. I just thought, well, I'm just gonna write a book, and it's, you know, my mother's from Germany and I wanna write this book. But the Lord has guided me. And so he guided me all through this time, and Letter to the American Church is like the follow-up to Bonhoeffer. Religionless Christianity is a little bit like the how-to.
Yeah,
right?
We need solutions.
If you say, okay, all right, I'm open, what do I do? Well, the first thing is to understand, are you in any way in your life being merely religious and not serving the Lord? And there are a lot of Christians. I mean, there's no pagans doing that. It's Christians that are saying, well, I'm religious and I go to church, I do this. But are you living out your faith? Are you angry at injustice? Are you activated? Bonhoeffer always talked about faith in action. And I think that's part of the heresy of the American church. We kind of like, well, it's all about faith. I believe. It's like, wait a minute. Yeah, you better believe. Mm. But if your faith is not lived out in every sphere, not everybody's called to be John Amanchukwu,
sure,
doing what he does. Not everybody's called to do what I do. We all have a different calling, but the Lord calls us to activate our faith, to live out our faith. And I think there are many in the church, many pastors, many Christians who have more trouble with the words that just came out of John Amanchukwu's mouth. I don't think he should say that. He shouldn't say that. They're more worried about that than they are that little children are being exposed to this.
Right.
That's a religious spirit. And so in religionless Christianity, I talk about what does real faith look like? In other words, do we have the discernment to say, wait a minute, that's just religion. What is God saying? So I mentioned a number of religious idols. And what is a religious idol of our time? It's the idol of winsomeness, right? It's good to be winsome. It's good to be at peace with all men. What is it? The scripture says, be at peace with all men where possible. Yeah. There's a time mm-hmm. when you're supposed to go to war. You're supposed to say, that's evil, and you might not like me, but I'm going to represent truth. And I think that that has crept into the church. That's just one idol, religious idol, but of winsomeness, that I'm always going to be sweet and get along and try to be unity and whatever. It's like, if people are trying to destroy your children, to sexualize and confuse your children, and you don't want to go to war over that because they think that'd be bad for your witness. What's bad for your witness is being silent in the face of evil.
I think one of the issues, and you know, I have an MDiv as well, so I understand pastors have been trained as one, I get it. You know, but I think one of the paradigms again is that a pastor is taught that he's to pastor a church and not a city. Okay, in the book of Revelation, they were taught to the pastor or of the city.
Yeah.
And I know pastors who understand that they're called to pastor a city, but they're the ones who go to the lawyer association as well as the pastor's association.
Yes.
They're the one who visit the doctors, not because they're sick, but because they want to pray for them.
Yes.
And they're the ones who go to business owners and say, do you have a pastor? No, I am your pastor. This is my city and I'm your pastor. If you have a problem, call me. Okay, and we don't have that. I'm almost like the church almost needs to take the mafia mentality. Like, this is my town.
You know, I was gonna say,
this is my town.
It's like,
and on my town, this is what happens. And my kids don't get perversion in their school.
That's right,
and if they do, I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna let the entire school board out of my own church.
There's literally a story in religionless Christianity about what you just said about a pastor that wanted to go to a hearing to oppose this satanic sexual stuff being put in the schools. His elder board said, no, we're not allowed to go to that. Stay out of that.
Yeah.
He didn't go. The evil stuff was passed. And he came to me in the parking lot after I spoke on the letter of the American Church and basically repented. And I said, well, the Lord's going to give you more opportunities.
Amen.
He's calling every one of us to get past this religious spirit and to be vocal for him. And listen, if the church doesn't do this, it is game over for the United States of America, and people will suffer, and the Lord will hold us accountable because he appointed us to stand.
Amen. Exactly.
And again, I want to come back to that because there are some of you that there have been some things that have happened in your family and it has directly affected you, and you've never been involved, and yet you have the gifts, you have the talents, you have the wherewithal to get involved. And for the first time, there's a stirring going on. It's time for you to stand up. There are others that are believing God for a loved one that is away from God. And that's why I wanted Eric to share his story, because God can give a dream. He can send people across their path. But I want you to be persistent in understanding that they were born for such a time as this, and God is going to get a hold of their heart. So don't you give up on them. And if that's you today, if any of what I just shared is who you are, I want you to call and let us pray with you. You don't have to give us your name, address, any of that, but just let us pray for you, because there is an awakening that's coming, and God's going to use some very unusual people that I think the church will be surprised at. When you think about people like Bill Maher, who is saying some of the stuff that he's saying, who has been the most left, most, you know, agnostic, atheist, whatever you want to say, which what you used to be, it's like there is like, it's like something's being peeled
something
back.
Something is happening that we've never seen in our lifetimes. And it's because the evilness of evil is so clear that anybody with a modicum of common sense says, wait a second.
That's all.
That's insane.
Yeah.
And so they start. So Bill Maher is, you know, he still hates Christians
God.
Whatever, but guess what? He is on team reality.
Right.
He starts seeing things. He's calling out.
Right.
If you're on team reality, guess what? You're not far from the kingdom. You might hate the idea of but you are, because the Lord created reality. You can't kick against the goats, right? That's where we are. And that's why, I say to people, just, if you're in a church, give your pastor a letter to the American church, because I wrote this to reach those that are in the middle, to say, is this biblical, brothers? Is what I'm writing just some political screed, or is this what the word is teaches? This is what history teaches us. Because I really believe, I say this is the hour of the American church in the documentary film, because I really believe this is our moment. And in religionless Christianity, the whole point of it is, would it be possible that if the Lord gives his people the ability to fight now, we don't just avert evil, we open the door to kingdom stuff.
Oh no, revival.
In history.
We need a revival.
That we will see, it will be revival and reformation.
Absolutely.
We will see things. And I want to encourage people, but we have to fight. We have to understand we're in a war. And Joni, you said before that this is like the third existential crisis. I write in the book, this is the third existential crisis in our history. The first is the revolution, second is the Civil War. We are now in a war with globalist,
Yes.
Atheistic thinking that is so evil, and the Lord is pointing to the American church. So if somebody listening right now, if you're going to a church that's not dealing with this, I beg you to get out of that church. Mm-hmm. I beg you to get out yesterday. I beg you to be the church and to lead the way. Take your friends out of that church, because we don't have time. The Lord has cursed the fig tree. It's not bearing fruit. Get out. Go to a place where they're taking this seriously. And again, at the website, Letter to the American Church, is a list of churches that are doing free screenings. Any church can do a free screening. Just go to the website, letterthemericanchurch.com. Any church in the world can do a free screening.
And we see the church was tested with COVID as to whether it was going to bow or not.
That's right.
And so we already know who the men's and the boys are.
Yep.
There's the men's side who kept the churches open and just say, I'm going to do it.
Yeah.
Right? And I went to a church like that. And then there's the guys who want to be happy and, you know, passive.
Yeah.
So we already know that team. And then there's the other team. The other thing that the line in the sand was the war, the Israel war.
Oh.
Are you going to stand with my people?
Or you know, or rejoicing over Roe v. Wade.
Roe v. Wade.
All this
thirst.
Stuff. But
yes.
I mean, do we ever dream that in a few years we would see these things over and over? And again, this is the Lord's wake-up call.
Yes,
this
it is
his mercy to us, to allow these things to happen, to wake up his people for the future. If we do it now and we get serious now, and listen, there are many people who got it wrong during COVID that they could repent.
Absolutely.
They could turn around and say, like, you know what? We're not going to get it wrong now. I was fooled once, but now
exactly.
I have been activated, you know?
Amen.
And so I am ultimately hopeful, but we have to understand we're in a war. And even at the end of the book, I talk about, if you said George Washington in 1776, how's it going? He would say, it's not going well. But because it was not in the natural, no way should they have won. No way.
Right.
And their voices today saying, well, it's not going well. So let's just, you know, go and have a quiet time. Mm-hmm. And I don't want to fight. Washington said, it's not going well. But if the Lord be with us in this cause of liberty, we fight on and we fight on, and the Lord can give us the victory.
Amen.
Our job is to fight and pray. And there are many people that say, well, it's over, we're under judgment, there's nothing we can do. That's the voice of the devil.
Yeah.
That's not God's voice.
And what would you say quickly to the church worldwide? Because Daystar is global, going to every country right now. What would you say to those Christians watching?
Well, look, it's the same message. I would say, number one, to people who are not in America, I beg of you, pray for the American church.
Mm-hmm.
Pray for the American church, because the American church is appointed by God to stand, and we have abilities and freedoms here that many don't have around the world. And I really do believe it is for the sake of others. It's for the sake of the other nations.
Yeah.
That if America goes down, if the American church doesn't stand now, it's others in other nations. If you care about China, if you care about people all around this world, it is the American church that the Lord has called uniquely, and not because we're better. It's kind of like when he chose Israel. It's like he chooses you for trouble. You're going to have a lot of trouble. But the Lord has chosen the American church, and it's why I wrote Letter to the American Church, because anybody can get this. Or, you know, the principles are there, but ultimately, I say to the American church, you are the ones who have been given freedom. It's enshrined in your founding documents. If you do not live this out, the judgment will be far greater on you in the American church.
And if America falls, the rest of the world has no chance.
There's no doubt. That's why when people talk about empires and stuff, I'm thinking, I get that, but you know what? There's never been an America in the history of the world. When you talk about that empire, the Roman Empire was immoral. The Roman Empire was not fundamentally undergirded by Christian principles.
That's
it didn't come into being because of that.
Right.
So the Lord has called us. He's given us a holy burden in America. And the Lord is calling his people to rise up now. The time could not be shorter. Amen.
Well, we got people who've called in, Eric. Would you mind just putting your hand over here and praying for them? They've called from all over the world. You just pray for them.
Abba, Father, we love you. We trust you, Lord God. You are the name above all names. Yours is the name above all names. And in your name, Jesus, we pray over every concern. Lord, before time, you knew these things. And we ask you, Father, sovereignly, by the power of your Holy Spirit, to touch every person involved, every person who has sent in a prayer request, all those who are listening, by the power of your Spirit now, Lord, touch them, touch them, touch them. Slay them in your Spirit. Heal them.
Yes,
activate their faith. Let them be born again. Let them be anointed afresh. Father, we pray for signs and wonders and miracles and giftings. Release them now.
Yes,
we release them in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
To God's glory, in Jesus' name. Amen.